the executive and the decision session. Good luck. Just going through the agenda. Item one, declaration of interest, which is already declared. Second item, minutes of meeting of our agenda. Participation, we have one registered speaker.
I don't mind any comments if you might follow on that. My name is Samuel Byron, I'm a Republican resident and I'm here to speak on behalf of the UK petition. Reducing waste going to landfill and disposing of all our waste smartly and appropriately should be a paramount goal of any local council. Green waste can be composted, fed straight back into the ecosystem and so should be prioritised alongside local recycling. At present, all the collections do not accept garden waste and it is not permitted on the garden waste collection rooms to be part of the additional garden waste subscription scheme. 75% of households typically afford an autonomous garden waste collection rooms and despite any gardens. We believe a subscription system or flexible service could be extended if everyone requires it, perhaps by cooperating with residents and scheduling collections which serve local properties. This petition was signed by residents from 80% of East Harbour Road households. This demonstrates overwhelming evidence that this service is needed and wanted. There are many other streets in the UK who also want to be able to scratch it, so this petition should call for justification and undertaking further investigation. East Harbour Road residents said that these collections did used to happen regularly, that they would like them collected at the same time as normal grey bins and recycling boxes, and that garden sacks would be more convenient for bins for residents to manage and store. Other councils in the country are setting a trend by offering those services. For example, in the East Friday, ground bins are provided when collected, making up a bulky collection for the garden waste, using green ground bins. Leeds Council offers an online booking system for those houses who do not have ground bins and collected four lots of provided garden waste for those who do. In Lambeth, I'm working with residents who arrange weekly garden collection waste at a cost of £70 per annum. This is collected on the same day as other option recycling and is collected. Cancellation of garden waste sack, which is in the store end. There is no additional fee for residents who need larger collections if they put out an additional cost for bags. To summarise, we do not entirely support either option suggested in the report, as there is clearly a plan for mandate for green waste collection, and it's something that should already be given to the standard. Residents would much prefer sacks, which are way more convenient than bins, and we see no reason why green waste bags would not be collected for buying waste of their own, regardless of.
There has been a move from black sacks to green
opportunity for a wonderful country to serve China. So this is the quarterly date.
One of the big issues that I talk about six along the public
access to the site. And that may lead the board to work afterwards. But again, we can look at that in more detail as we move forward. Then we look at just at the kind of thought on the second part called South Bank. And there will be a property proceedings. And we've currently set these new dates around when the contract will be cured on the going out to the members of the residents about that. Again, they should all be aware of that, the premium, the latest information that we get just to reiterate that that proportion has slipped due to the national contract.
And as we said, the last time we really called it to understand things like that beforehand, so that they can move it through the channels.
And at that point, obviously, this has not changed from last time, it's just the information. Looking at B10, Walkwick, my application is in for that currently. Obviously, we've got a lot of interest being into Triple SI. At the moment, we're looking to extend the embankment both on the north and south, plus raise it. And part of that work, we're looking to stabilise the current bank, which has an issue around drawdowns, basically, going to the reservoir, and there's a risk of actually pulling the embankments in as a water pressure, as the water pressure drops on the right side, if that makes sense.
Then we need to go through that again.
Well, simply, the embankment requires is that structural risk failure when we take out water within years.
Right.
So as part of this work, we need to fix that, so it isn't so far in the future.
Good.
We'll also be looking at compensation at Bloomberg as well. So that, say, is in planning. We're expecting termination on the 25th of April, or thereabouts. Following that, we'll then look to take it forward and we're aiming to try and start construction in sort of June, July, for July time this year. Moving now to D11, Cricket Farm to Scarlet Bridge, so that's St Peter's School. Again, we're talking to the school about that. We're trying to tie it in with school holidays. As part of the year's work, still on there, we'll be looking to potentially using works around that airfield to potentially make, or we'd like to take some of the airfields out for a 12-month period. So we are working with them. We're not technically planning for that, it's a plan of information development, but we'll still go out and talk to you about it. But we're looking to get full business case, I think it's on the table in the back, things in April, you know, full business case goes in. And then we'll be looking at starting work probably sometime.
So just to check in terms of it not needing to come into the handles, residents know what to do with the roads.
Well, we've already talked to some residents anyway around that, but we will have drop into a lot of areas, less shops, etc. to make sure that we get our representation. We're not going to do it in the dark. And again, one of the key elements to that is the access to the site. And that is an engineering ahead of the Westminster Road, which, you know, is the only access to the site. So it will need room and quite a lot of worries in and out of there, moving higher to. So that will impact, so we need to stop and be able to really understand how we can best do that to meet their as well as students. Moving just downstream to that, so what could be 12, which is Scarlet Bridge to London Bridge. Again, that's ongoing. We're talking to the museum and the museum trust about that. We are trying to work out if we can do the earthworks through the park in a more sensitive way to avoid the need to delay due to waiting. We think we've got a way forward. Means of winter working, which should be an issue for the raising of the walls, but maybe an issue for the park. Maybe they'll do a quite small period of installing a location. moving further on to Fosbury then on the page 19 of the report. Fosbury, just wanted to report it was progressing at speed. We've now got new condition work we mentioned the last time. So just on the siege report being said 17 million, we're now looking to spend £28 million to Fosbury. So that's including the furnishing gates, replacement of the gates. Now, the other thing that's happening as well is the concrete blocks in St. George's Park are going to come down. So from Easter, we're going to start taking that out. And we will probably take about 2 months to remove them all. But again, the good news for the residents, St. George's, the blocks sit here for the winter notice, which is not going to happen. So it's not deep light by that, I think. So things will improve. That on the individual cells, think through what I wanted to say. Just briefly moving on to the engagement. There's not a vast amount of engagement. Obviously we're recruiting around the local elections. We will be some ongoing engagement during that period, but it will be limited due to the arrangements around the local elections. We're expecting though that from June, July and August will probably be quite heavy. The following table was issued from last time, and Steve's actually following the comments from last time. I'm not going to take you through that detail, I'm sure you've got a chance to have a look at it. But again, any feedback, has it got the right information, do you need more information? So that concludes all I have to say. See you later if you've got any comments around on that.
No, just really reinforce that pace and progress on this has been obviously a pressure raised, not just at this meeting, but you know, in all the sessions that we've held in public and in the departments. And hopefully we can see there's going to be construction on the site on four cells, certainly during this year. And the planning commission in place for those with tangible step in that. We recognise the work of all the environmental teams on this, but we need to keep that progress on. That's the message that we give as a council and the residents.
A few questions. Numerous things that have been implemented in the And it would be useful to have a holistic approach to do that. And maybe you can not have to understand this part of
the truth. Yeah, so we're looking at mitigation and the normalization. So I think you want to say it's a 5-1 ratio for the treatment to take out of the 5. Maybe not that, in the best way, but not that simple patient could be good, or the best patient would want to be of the aware.
So you'll be doing that across the piece, and there'll be some tree planting streams, or you'll be looking for posts and that sort of thing.
Well, yes, so again, we're working with a number of organisations to look at what tree planting can do on the street as well. So, yeah, obviously, that will produce both on the environment and also produces the digital
in relation to the meetings that are taking place with the Northern Forest, in particular the Wireless Forest, which would fall into that partnership with the Outbreak Offices of Preparing with the Water Programme, identifying the equipment just publication for the next to the signing to the part of the Northern Forest with the Wireless Forest Partnership. Tree planting, so that all community council works. Just going through some questions that might have been the way in which flood granting aid works, that is directed on defending houses. Therefore, if you have a road that is prone to be affected by flooding, for instance, 50 green, then that doesn't qualify in the same way.
It's, yes, it still has benefits. So what we've done is that there's our own model. But it does limit the way we go to the ability of the property.
So given the projects that have happened around the region for protection of transport links, for the council of the Burdock Pumping Station, bringing that business case to fruition, it would be worth how we do that in conjunction with labs and other organisations.
I think, if I may, that's one of the recommendations in the next item, the Section 19 for investigation regarding the so at the moment, the flood cell, it comes to St. Peter's school area and downstream, and includes Burdock. With the existing model of the vibrancy of schools, it really showed a case for flood works on the pumping station. One of the things that we're discussing now is we need a wider, holistic model that takes on board which causes the structure, so a really detailed degree, the highway frame of the structure to a detailed degree, the main river. Structure and also just wider surface water there, and that would be the next to the little things because Ben says the benefit cost of
water and water. They have entered the Ofwat's view of their programme, so they are that too. Are we clear of what that means for pumping stations for the purging of independent areas?
Yeah, the other water, we've not seen the results of the R19 yet, as I'm fully aware. The other water have been engaging with Ben and colleagues and consultants and individual cells. So, for example, planning for assessing the topic, planning for talking to them regarding potential public requirement for works and scalping for the cells. So, at the minute, it's happening on a cell by cell basis. As always happens in this period, past students in the Coastal Chester, but they are certainly aware of what we perceive as the investment calls upon them
effectively reporting because there was a clear ambition, notably in the Yorkshire Public Coastal Committee, that we needed to service this significant investment. They were mindful of what they needed to contribute to their aspect. Could you offer that they would work together to support the case? Because I'm sure that scenarios that are going to get included. So, just to, as I mentioned at the beginning, there was inclusion in the capital programme. For schemes and within the budget papers, the Shipton Road, the Way, Clifton Road, Terrace Street River Cross, Bishop Hill Road, River Ouse, and Neighbour were specifically identified as areas for that type of activity, which would be able to facilitate. Just on the individual property resilience, clearly we're going to go out to some households and say that is what we are anticipating for your house. I'm aware of work that's doing for me and them in terms of helping to advise residents the most appropriate and most effective property equipment. This is a whole raft of things out there, and your household are not doing this purchasing on a regular basis. So, how is that information being passed on to the public?
So, from our side, we bring people to do surveys on the property. They'll do a survey and they'll have a recommendation based on that survey. That will be down to the residents to then make a decision on what they want to say on the money available. So that's from our people what we'll be looking at. We're happy to sit down and talk in detail with residents about each individual case. We're not the ones to recommend it, it's been done independent of the survey. And as part of the framework of the environment we see is now in place for property resilience, there's a report provided to the homeowner at the end of installation showing which measures have been implemented on their property, gives them the ongoing advice on maintenance and installation, etc. Advises that footprints form or that footprints exist. Individuals are there, advise the site one, etc. Correct answer is that why it's the environment is fully involved in as well, which is part of the legacy communications, which is referenced in the annex, which is much wider than just talking about particularly resilience products, but also its annual campaigns to inform people of impacts, flooding, talking about resilience and understanding of
And in the table of activities that we've got, there is an element of overlap with major highways, works, Scarborough Bridge. So it's useful on both sides to work together on that.
Yeah, we'll fill in through C. I think C sits on the group that goes through, so we would obviously improve if we were working more closely than us, right? And obviously, we're really anxious to move forward.
Questions, please?
Yes.
So, great thing with respect to that, the information, chair that spot. We do get the screen back. Cells in the outline business case, so feasibility is described in there. We usually for management of fuels and give those communications and obviously really is interesting. Coming out of feasibility phase, which is what that's very usual for citizens to grow to understand how long this is going to go on for. So we know these cells don't sit here for a year, so we can tie into the space. So, you should understand managing public expectations and delivering that item. The other is that we've got the 11 cases that are in the final business case, none of them are going to find the key business case outside, they're not costly. So again, I think it can be useful to understand paper for themselves to how we then prioritise, because to the extent scheme 1 comes in 20% more, scheme 2 20% more, well actually is scheme 1 or 2 the top priority if there's only a finite amount of money available. So I absolutely understand that it's not something that you can sit now and prioritise, which you don't know those the funding requirements, but I think priority of how that mechanism in principle would work, so that we can understand what that would be in terms of ourselves holding on to task as it were, in terms of that prioritisation in a visible and transparent manner, how that might work would be really useful addendum to what we've got. I think those two pieces would improve the accountability of the amount of agency to them, so we can work on that. Are they possible?
Both are possible. The previous meetings we've gone through the prioritisation process, which was a good fight up there. And again, those big data out for those who want as well.
The prioritising management process is becoming real though, in terms of these
things.
When you start to see figures appear in these boxes, it's a real need.
Having a figure of $1 million, see how big each of the cells. And whilst we have the ending of the 6-year in 2021, this whole scheme project will overlap that, and I appreciate there's already 18 million pounds in the notional figures for the year after this artificial accounting division. But most things will, by the end of the following 6 year, thereabouts in terms of the scale of what it is you're doing, and as you develop the programs and you can see the actual cost on the ground, then there's going to be a further or what it is important to demonstrate that we collectively spend the money.
We also
that has
Okay, well, with those additional recommendations that I would have. Cool. So that brings us on to item six, which is the service water closing destination.
Well, so it's on.
This report is submitted to introduce the section 19 service water investigation report into the events of the Colwell 13th August 2018. Section 19 investigation is something that we as the legal full authority carry out under the Flood and Water Management Act, and section 19 of the Act asks that we investigate the events that happened during a flood events and identify all the parties that were involved and their roles and their actions during the events. The report is attached as an expanded report and essentially it works through the individual authorities that were involved, the lead up to the events, so the forecasting and the weather radar showing the actual prevention when it did fall, that's the section 2 report. We identified through print media, broadcast media, social media, direct reports into the council and from other parks through light services, 123 locations where there were flooding issues during the event. Now, I don't suspect that's any source of this, there will be other locations around the city, but they're the ones that were brought to us during the directly or by those investigations. The investigation that we carried out at each one of those sites is given an annex 1, so you can see in there the priority of the sites we've given, the individual investigations being carried out, and then the resultant outputs of that investigation and any further recommendations. We've then provided under section 3 reports some narrative commentary on those investigations, which goes by ward across the city and gives further description of those investigations that have taken place. And give more detail for the board members or residents reading this report to understand better what happened in their location. And then the report puts together recommendations and conclusions to what happened on the day. There are 60 recommendations in the main report, but they've been condensed down into 6 recommendations within the covering reports. And I'll just run through those just to close and then welcome any questions. The first one is that we'll continue to work with all partners to develop an increased understanding of flood resilience. This event was 40 millimetres of rain in 50 minutes, which is over 100 millimetres per hour of rainfall, which is an extreme rainfall event. I realise that we use the precedent of an extreme and all these superlatives far too easy, but this was an extreme rainfall event. We would have expected standing water on the roads, we would have expected standing water in unpaved and even unpaved areas with that sort of intensity of rainfall. And we need to think about fusion and what might mean for us. So we need to convey those issues wider amongst our residents and our communities. We will be reviewing our local fluid management strategy, which is again another required for the Water Management Act. We will release this year or next year alongside the European Floods Directive, which will still be in force no matter what happens. So that would be a good time to do that. We've also just talked about the legacy communications and the fact that the agency colleagues from the environment agency, and again, we've got opportunities to reinforce those messages there. So we found that there were a lot of locations in 123 where we didn't find any particular issues with the highway drainage infrastructure or Yorkshire Water and their investigations, and found any particular problems with their infrastructure. But there were some locations where further work was needed, some locations that require maintenance and cleansing, blockages and receiving pipework or the hydro drainage infrastructure. And Yorkshire Water continuing investigations in different places, and we will continue the same across our housing infrastructure. Recommendation two is really just to recognise that we've talked in this meeting before about the review that we're carrying out of our highway maintenance practices, including management review, and that when we bring in further outputs from that, that given what we've observed in the investigation report here, that we continue to support the issues that we've got from that. Recommendation three is that we will raise awareness of surface water management techniques with planning partners and internal teams in general that have picked up various tiers there. We need to continue to highlight the importance of effective surface water management when we develop management applications. One of our engineers sits permanent with planners to advise on planning applications, and we get some fantastic outputs from many planning applications. But we need to keep that and continue that innovative approach to surface water management. But also when colleagues are designing highway schemes and other colleagues of regeneration in the past, the council do understand the needs of surface water management, not just now, but into the future. So again, to roll up the limits of other items around that, which recommendations for that. Recommendation four talks about the awareness that can bring forward during the event that can bring forward. We use rain gauge data from a number of sources to investigate these different schemes, to look at how we can gather information from these reports and each other's recommendations. And there's a recommendation that put together a report for the executive to identify funding to put in place a network of rain gauges across the city. This would only be a small network. We've already talked to colleagues in the UI, and they already have a system in place. And there are opportunities to get synergies with their system and utilize some of the software and approaches that they use. So we're already looking into that even ahead of this recommendation. We think we believe that having that better understanding of the rainfall that's falling currently, but also what's happening to the investigative position better. Recommendation 5 is just to recognize that there's a lot of work already happening. Sites that can manage one of the reports, either by City or Council, Yorkshire Water, or both authorities. But there are some investigations that require more work just to recognise the fact that this is a conclusion. And the recommendation 6 pulls together a number of recommendations from the report regarding Westfield Beck Pump Station. Westfield Beck Pump Station is an important asset which manages surface water and river drainage infrastructure to the west of practically. There were some issues which are documented in the reports regarding the ownership and maintenance and management of that installation. So recommendation 6 of the covering reports shows identifies that we will take the lead in ensuring that Yorkshire Water and the internal drainage board are currently responsible to better understand their role, better understand the operation and better understand the future needs. That's
all right.
City Council scheme, Yorkshire Water are not involved now identified is Car Lane, the drainage system for Car Lane, that's the public entry road drainage system, but also the drainage from the area behind the petrol station, so Sitwell Road, the other areas behind that, which sit on into the drain, or alternatively known as Car Lane, so it's changed to name of places. Both that area from Innscliff Drain and the area from Car Lane pass into the downstream part of that system, which would pass under the church. And both of those pipes have been put in at various times over the number of years ago, are set lower than the pipe that received the flow that passes down to the roofs. So there's a, in terms of hydraulic jump, there's already a blockage in the system. So we've identified that the in a bypass track to actually provide a high level, well, a little overflow for flood flows.
Right.
So we will improve the conveyance of flood flows systems in times of floods. And that's program didn't start, what program didn't start at the end of this month, it might, may not be just as next month as we try to work around the things that happen in the environment. But that work will be majority completed at least by the end of the year. So we believe that should improve the hydraulic efficiency of the Car Lane system, and that's Innscliff Drain, Car Drain system significantly. And I'm also talking with Network Rail this morning, because that would also go to the railway embankments, and I've had a very positive response from Network Rail this morning, that they want to ensure the section. Yeah, as I said, there are a number of locations where we believe those issues with West Kilbeck were issues. So, obviously, a positive resolution of West Kilbeck situation will actually use a number of locations in
the area. So, we have
a further resolution needed there.
Seven. Again, that's an additional pulley time frame for that. Kensington Street, can you do this more regularly?
That was bound to be different than it was there. I don't know to what extent that that's exacerbated the situation, but to be honest, it's extremely
painful. Right.
It's certainly one of those times.
So that was factored into the regular.
Yeah, no problem. This is going to be a slightly larger scheme. This is a repeat of the issue. We've worked with Yorkshire Water on that now. So, as I said, there's no Yorkshire Water Authority.
Sure.
We think that there's a capacity issue there. It's a very old part of the sewage system, and they're looking to that alongside. But we may also, as I say, in here in the main reports, we may need a belt and braces. Boundary wall around those properties and putting this sort of wall property that is linked to the field wall site gate rather than the existing pulley gate. So that would be a scheme where I would look to incorporate the local level as part of the
workshop. Right.
I'll need to find more about that. So again, we didn't find any particular issues there, so that could both be a consequence of the extreme rainfall. We need to look at that, but also identify that.
104, this time trial, Yorkshire Water, so we have to know what's that in there.
Yes, yeah.
Then 104, another line on there.
Yeah, not a lot of detail on that, so we need to. Sometimes some of these things are only in set themselves.
Yes.
And then one more fire, one more road. Yorkshire Water have actually put in place a capital scheme there. Right. So we'll talk to Yorkshire Water about whether or not that's effective as they need to.
So there's quite a lot of ongoing items in that. Because there are a number of prepared for that. There is that item I don't think we're in urgent business, so I